So great to be back. It's it feels almost like family reunion. So when you stand out there and then all these known faces come back that you haven't seen partly for years. So it's fantastic to be back and to see you all. And this place is for me always a bit like home. And every time I come back to Heidelberg and then you come up the hill and see Villa Bosch, it feels really like coming home in a way. Yeah? And as Wolfgang just said, it's been a long time ago, 1997, when I joined EML. And this was a fabulous time and it just started. And by that time, I was actually the only scientist at Villa Bosch and at EML. So I came before Andreas Reuter. And then things started and grew. And now EML was divided into EMLD and EMLR. And then HITS evolved out of that. And so a lot of things started, like the studio came that wasn't here when I started. And I left then 2006. And went to Bremen for a professorship in digital media. And digital media as a professorship, I can tell you, it's almost as cool as EML because when I went to EML, people told me that's a cool place. You can do whatever you want. You just have to convince Klaus. And as a professor for digital media, you can almost also do what you want. And because nobody knows what digital media is. Yeah. So in a way, everything is digital media. And so I kept keeping the portfolio quite large, even though there is some focus, and you will see it in a minute. This is my group here at EML in the winter when we had a group meeting in 2001. This is my group today in 2019. So there are some years in between, some hair left on my head, and they more turned gray. And at least you should recognize a few of you here, yeah, and you can still recognize maybe me, but you can also recognize this guy, maybe Robert Porzel, who is still at University of Bremen. So best regards from him. Now moving from this area to Bremen was quite a transition. Yeah, so from the Palatinate area to the Hanseatic area, but we also have historical buildings, we also have some cultural heritage, but we don't have any mountains and we don't have any hills, it's all flat. So landscape-wise, it's pretty boring, and so we have to focus on research and to no mountain biking, and so we have to do research and we have to do work. We do that at the university, and Andreas just said, I have so many titles there, but I wanted just to introduce you a bit of what I'm doing right now. So one of the hats I'm wearing is I'm a director of the Center for Computing Technologies at University of Bremen. This is an institute with 13 research groups, around 160 employees. And we have computer science and also a bit of electrical engineering in there. And we have three larger areas. One is closely linked to my work, and I'm also directing that, Empowering Digital Media. And the other two are EASE Innovation. EASE stands for Everyday Activities, Science and Engineering. So the core there is understanding everyday activities in a way that you can teach it to robots. So it's about basically household robots. And the third one is more in the communication technology area, adaptive communication. I myself, I'm directing a research group which we call Digital Media Lab, which is nice because I didn't have to change so much from European Media Lab to Digital Media Lab, just from E to D. But And in a way, some topics are still quite similar to what I did before here at EML or at Villa Bosch. So a large focus of what we are doing is in human-computer interaction. What came and what I haven't done before is entertainment computing. This came somehow due to the students. So they come and say, I want to do a bachelor thesis, master thesis in computer games. And so I somehow got drawn by our students into entertainment computing. And now I'm also chairperson of IFIP TC14 on entertainment computing. So I try to organize science in that area also in the scientific community. And I still have some link to AI, so semantics and context is still somewhere in there. Now, coming to the title of the talk, I had to change that. So I usually say empowering digital media, and we also called this like research area empowering digital media, and then some people told me that can be misunderstandable, yeah, because empowering digital media, you could interpret that in a way that you want to empower the digital media. Yeah? And this is not what we want to do. So we understand empowering digital media more like helping hands. So more in the way that digital media should empower people. Yeah? And so for disambiguating that, I kept this title now in empowering people with digital media. Now, what is that about? So it's about digital media. And digital media is, well, the force that transforms our society in our everyday life, in the way we meet our friends, in the way we talk to each other, in the way how business is done. And digital media, of course, pervasive, so they go into everything, everywhere, everybody. And the big thing is, of course, they are interactive, but also active and immersive, and they drive the digital revolution. And some people say, or think maybe, well, but everything is there now, no? So we have digital media, we have ubiquitous computing, but this is not the end of the story. Yeah? So having a smartphone and a flat screen, this is not the end. Yeah? And what's coming up now, I think, is an even bigger transition in society, because digital media become physical. So they become active in our everyday life. And one of these agents could be a robot, yeah, in your household, taking care for older people or for, yeah, for your kids even. Yeah. So Japanese work on that. Other agents, highly discussed at the moment, self-driving cars. Yeah. So digital media is not anymore something behind a glass screen, yeah, but it's active in your everyday life. And that's a big difference, and that's a big changer. And nevertheless, still, digital media is something that gives us superhuman capabilities. Yeah? So we are more powerful. And I took one slide Andreas Reuter might recognize, this one, about the power of digital media. I stole that like 20 years ago from Jim Gray when he visited EML. And I still like it a lot. Yeah? So this is illustrating the data that digital media can collect and how much data you can collect now. And 20 years ago, collecting the data that you can watch over a lifetime was still a bit far ahead. But today, that is possible. Yeah? And when we talked about that 20 years ago, collecting all the data that you hear in your lifetime was still a bit far ahead, but close to reality. And today that we have Alexa, that we have Google, that's reality. Yeah? So Google is more or less listening to you all the time. Alexa's listening to you. You don't know what is stored. Yeah? Maybe a lot of what you talk is already stored. So digital media is there. We have huge amounts of data. And what's happening with that? Today, when we look at the products and at the market, most digital media are bought, are developed with customers in mind. Yeah? So digital media, if you look at Google, Amazon, Apple, etc., their main focus is they want to sell products to customers. Yeah? So this is the drive of the industry. Well, clear, they are business companies. Yeah? But can we also build digital media that really help us in our everyday life? This is a question I want to give you today. And this is what I want to talk about when I talk about empowering digital media, yeah? Empowering people with digital media and not having only the customer in mind who wants to buy something. And for setting the stage for that, I want to give you a bit of an overview of human-computer interaction and the history or the development of human-computer interaction. The very early phase of human-computer interaction, if you like, was software ergonomics, or ergonomics in the way of how to set a screen on a desk, yeah? how far you should sit from the screen, how big the font should be. And the idea was to avoid harm. And then, around the 80s, people came up with the concept of usability. Yeah, usability is very much about how to be as efficient as possible, yeah? How can you be as effective as possible, and how can you solve problems, how can you solve your task. People found out this is not the end of the story. And when the iPhone came out, people realized it's not only about task completion. Yeah? Why do people spend so much time with a smartphone? Yeah, it's not because you are more productive. It's because the thing is somehow appealing. Yeah? It drives you into it. Yeah? And the term that was coined then in the community is user experience. Yeah? And user experience in HCI is about how does the user feel when the user is using the product. And now the question is that the goal of human-computer interaction, or is that enough? Yeah? And if you optimize user experience, then you optimize that you feel happy, yeah? Or you enjoy the experience. Yeah? When YouTube is optimizing user experience, YouTube tries to suggest to you the next video that you might like. Yeah? And then you click the next video. And then after that video, YouTube is suggesting you the next video. And then you click that video. And who of you is having children? Yeah, I have. And then when they hang at YouTube, you don't get them off again. Yeah? Because user experience is so great that they keep on clicking the next video. The same holds for games in a way, and the same holds for other appliances, yeah? That by optimizing user experience, you stay for the most time or you optimize that people stay as long as possible with the gadget, yeah? And that's not really good, yeah? So the question is, how can we build systems, or how can we define HCI such that it really helps you to have a better life? Now, what do I mean with that? Imagine you are 80 years old. What is relevant then? Will you say it was so fantastic spending 10 years in World of Warcraft? Or having watched 20,000 YouTube videos? Is that what makes quality of life? Maybe not. Yeah? Maybe then you would say it was fantastic that I had kids, that I went outside, that I achieved something, that I did something good for the planet or whatever, saved the climate. Yeah? And so how can we do HCI in a way that you have something positive for your life? And this is an actual trend in HCI, yeah? Going beyond user experience. Some people coin that positive computing or eudaimonic HCI. And this term eudaimonic goes back to Socrates. And his definition of ethics said there are three kind of ethics. Yeah? You can be driven by utility. This then leads to utilitarianism. You can be driven by pleasure. Then you have hedonism. Or you can be driven by happiness. And this brings you to eudaimonia. Now, we as Germans don't really have a good understanding of distinguishing the latter two. Yeah? So happiness and pleasure for us sounds pretty much the same. Yeah? And Kant, in a way, this is like our godfather of philosophy, he was completely into utility, yeah? And he neglected the other two. But the Americans and in the Anglo-Saxon philosophy, they had John Locke, and they have another understanding of this happiness term. And the pursuit for happiness, yeah? You know that from the American Constitution, this is for them like a goal in human life. Yeah? And this is not about being like just happy. Yeah? It's about exactly what I told you, like when you look back in your life, what was important? Yeah? What is the real thing that matters for you? And the question is, how can we build products that rather optimize eudaimonia than hedonism? and that help you to be better in whatever you do as a human. Now, this is what we understand by empowering people with digital media, and this is what drives us at the moment. This is what I'm obsessed with when I work in flat Bremen. Yeah? So I want to build systems like that. Yeah? And what do I mean by that? I want to support people in a sustainable way. I don't want to have computers that remote control humans, yeah? But I rather want to emphasize that people are competent and I want to help them in their competence. And the idea is to have meaningful, playful, and natural interaction. Now, what do I mean with that? And I want to go into more details here and show you a bit examples of what we do and what we think is meaningful, playful, and natural, of course. Okay, meaningful. What is meaningful interaction? Meaningful, in our sense, means that you know what you do and you have a meaningful activity. Here's an example. Navigation systems. Everybody hears and knows about these news about accidents that happen because people got misled by GPS systems or navigation systems in their car. Yeah? And they are partly quite funny. Yeah? So you have these Japanese tourists who drove into the Pacific. Yeah? This is a nice headline for a newspaper. Yeah? And the media like to report on that. And people think, yeah, funny. Yeah? But maybe not all these cases are funny. And if you look at this case, maybe the first reaction is rather ouch, yeah, and not so funny. And in TCI, my colleague Johannes Schöning, he did a study on GPS accidents, and they had a look on what happened and why did these things happen. And they collected a lot of these things here. This is another interesting thing here, California. GPS led people into areas where there were fires. Yeah? And then the police had to warn people not to go there. Yeah? So the Los Angeles Police Department asked drivers to avoid navigation apps, which are steering users onto more open routes, in this case, streets in the neighborhoods that are on fire. Obviously, yeah, because the GPS or the navigation systems say, well, these routes are all free, so let's put the traffic there, but then you end up in the fire. That might not be a smart thing. Now, if you look at these accidents, it looks funny, but it might not have been funny for the driver. If you look at these accidents, you find that quite some of them are untypical. Yeah? So you have a lot of single vehicle collisions that usually don't happen. So that's a typical accident due to these misled things, or that cars get stranded or struck. So quite a number of cars that have these problems. Now, if you look a bit closer, why does it happen? And maybe you had problems with your navigation system too and sometimes got misled. Yeah? Well, the one thing is, whenever you reduce complexity, you hide information. Yeah? And the idea of navigation systems is to reduce complexity. And this happens here, like you have this instruction, go the street and then turn right. Yeah? Let's have a look where that took place. It's somewhere in the US. I hope you can see that the contrast is not perfect. So this is a Google map here. Here's 6th Avenue, and here is a street where you want to turn right. Now, what you only faintly see is this here. There are like two little lines, and they are not relevant for the driver because these lines are a railway. Yeah? And when you go there, it actually looks like this. So the system tells you to, this is Google Street View again here, yeah? So the system tells you to go there, but here's a railway, and this is also paved. And now imagine when you're driving in your car, and it's dark, maybe a bit rainy, and then you get the instruction, go the next possible right. And then this railway track looks like a street. And so some people ended up on these railway tracks. and this can be fatal. And now the question is, who's to blame? Is it human error? And I would say no. It's bad design. So the problem is, we take away information, we simplify things, and our attention is limited, and so we have effects like attentional or cognitive tunneling, and it goes away from our awareness. So what's happening is, the smart guy delegates things to the system. The system is claiming, I'm intelligent, I do the job for you, yeah? And then this guy is a bit less smart. And then you can ask, is that what we want to do? Maybe you don't. And there's been a debate that's been going on for the last, I don't know, at least 15 years. What do we want? Do we want to have artificial intelligence, or do we want to have intelligence amplification? Do we want to have systems that take over our competencies, or do we want to have systems that support us in our competencies? And one answer was embodied interaction, so to put more intelligence into the interaction. Here's a classical example for that. That's a slide ruler, a pretty dumb piece of wood, yeah, with just some marks on it. But you can calculate logarithms, even though you might not know the formula. Yeah? But this makes you smarter without any digital technology, just because of the interaction is cool. But can we have the best of all worlds? So can we have smart systems, smart interaction, and still smart people? And this is what we want to strive for. And one kind of intelligent navigation system we are actually working on is one for surgeons. Here is the example. So this is a photo I took in Hamburg at Asklepios Hospital. And here are two surgeons doing an operation, and one of these laparoscopic operations works like this. You have a camera in there, and you have your operation tools in there in the belly. And here's the monitor. And then people have the split attention. They look to the monitor and do the treatment down there. And the question is, how can we support surgeons in the operation room? And one of the challenges there is when a doctor today plans an operation, before the operation, they have tons of data. Yeah? You have MRT, CT data, you have three-dimensional data. You can reconstruct quite a lot. So if you have a tumor resection, or if you have a liver tumor and you want to get that out, yeah, you know beforehand pretty well the three-dimensional structure. Yeah, and you can plan everything. Problem, when you are in the OR, so when the surgeon is here, then there's not much space for 3D interaction. So when you plan your operation, you know where the vessels are, you know where the nerves are. You did know that before, but in the OR, basically everything is gone. What doctors do is they have monitors outside of the sterile field. You see one over there. But they can't operate it because they have the hands busy and they need to be sterile. Now, people work with language interaction. People let other people control the monitor. Yeah? The nurse is controlling the mouse, yeah? Or some other doctor is doing that. But imagine you want to browse the web. Yeah? And you let your spouse do the keyboard and the mouse thing. Yeah? And then you say, click here, click there, please do that. This will definitely be critical for your marriage. Yeah? So don't do that. But similar in the OR, if you want to remote control, this is hard. So how can we get, and this is our question, how can we get the 3D information closer to the situs? How can we get that into the OR? And how can we build tools that help surgeons to have the information at hand? But again, without having the surgeon as like the remote controlled guy who's only doing what the system instructs the surgeon. Yeah? So we are a bit in the opposite to people who promote a lot like robotics in ORs, yeah, where the surgeon is only like the mechanic for controlling the robot, and the robot is doing everything at the end. So we still want to empower the surgeon to do it and to help the surgeon in his task or her task. There's quite some work that has been done already there. Yeah, people work with projections, for instance. This is not a living liver, so this is only swine liver, where people worked with projections and then did some tests there. What we did is we wanted to have tools that can give surgeons instructions or give the navigation information. And what I can show you here is two examples with radio or heat ablation. If you have a tumor, for instance, in the liver, sometimes you don't take it out, so you don't open it, but rather you put a needle in there. Then you go directly to the tumor, and at the tip of the needle, you deliver some radioactive substance. Or at the tip of the needle, you heat up. This would be then heat ablation. Or you cool down. This would be cryoablation. The point is, how do I get the needle in there? And the typical procedure is, as you saw on the other image, you put the needle there, have a tracking device, then you look at the monitor there, and you put the needle down there, and you don't see the patient. You only see the monitor, and you have to like do this. And our question was, how can we get that to the situs? And I want to show you two prototypes. One is this one here. Here we put LEDs on the needle. This is a very thick one, that's not a real needle. And this can indicate how deep you go and if your direction is correct. Here's a bit of a video. So when all green LEDs flash up, then your direction is correct. When the blue ones all flash up, then you are at the right depth. And then what you can't see here very well is when you overdo it, then they turn to red. So this is a video artifact, but you can see it a bit, it's going to red. And this would help the doctor to like look at where the thing happens, and the information goes to the situs. Here is a second prototype, a different approach where we work with electroluminescent displays. And they are pretty cool. So you have some electroluminescent ink. You print that via offset print, which is affordable and doable. So at least we can do it in the lab. So it's something that end users in principle could do. The cool thing is you can print it on like everything you want. You can print it on foil, you can print it on paper, you can print it on like wherever you want. And then you have a display, and that can be sterile. The print is not super expensive, so afterwards you can throw it away. You just have to cable it. So this is still a bit of a overhead, so you need some cables to cable that display. And here's an example, experiment with a phantom. So this is like one foil with that display. And imagine you put that on the patient. In the middle is a hole. And when you put the needle in there, it tells you with these rings around if your direction is correct. And then there is this. The other indicator telling you how deep you have to go and if you are at the right depth. So this is the one up there. And this is a simple phantom with a tumor. This is the red thing in there. And if you hit that, you don't see it from the outside, then you got the target. And we tried that out, and we could actually show that this is a better solution than the classical solution for doctors. Because task load goes down and people can better find the goal than with other technologies. A side aspect of this one was when we talked with people at Women's and Brigham Hospital and Harvard Medical School, they said, or what they do quite frequently is treatments within the MR scanner. In particular, when they do biopsies with prostate cancer, they do the treatment in the scanner because they need like the feedback of the scanner. And in the scanner, you can imagine it's like a 2 Tesla scanner, so it's a very, very strong magnet. You can't put any metal in there. So you can't put any display in there or anything. But, and this is what we tried out, you can put these printed displays in there. So you can print out a display, you can put that in there, and then guide a surgeon to find the target. And so this is like a matrix of such a display, and then you can guide the surgeon, and then they can pick the right targets. And again, we could show that this interface lowers the task load. So this is like the standard procedure. This is with our interface. And the usability is increased. So cool new technology for surgeons and for interaction navigation systems for surgery. Now, second thing I said, meaningfulness. Second thing is playfulness. Now, why playfulness? First of all, when people hear computer games, usually games are bad. Yeah? And I also have to keep my kids off from computer games. And people say games make you fat, lazy, and dumb. And there is evidence for that. So at least there are studies showing that the more time you spend in a computer game, the worse your body mass index gets. This is a body mass index. This is the time. It doesn't look alike, but it is a statistic significant result being published in the journal Eating Behavior. And however, maybe this is not representative for all kind of games. These were multiplayer online role-playing games, and maybe there are other games that are better. Yeah? And now we know there are serious games, and many of you heard about serious games. Serious games are cool, and maybe we can do interesting serious games. And if you talk about serious games, the first question is like, how old are serious games? So who knows how old are serious games? Who invented serious games? Anyone knows a serious game? Good question. What is a serious game? Does anyone know a serious game? No? Really? Yes?
For example, there's this game called Kerbal Space Program where you can actually learn something about flying to other planets and learning how to control.
Yeah, like this? Very popular serious game for those who are in protein folding. Rebecca should know that. Yeah? Folded. Yeah? Folded, Seth Cooper is the guy who did that, and we also had one PhD student at his lab, and we published a paper together. Folded is about protein folding, yeah? And you have like a puzzle, and people can try that out, get points, etc., yeah? And then you try to find protein foldings by involving people into games. Yeah? And people say chess is a serious game because it's about learning about strategy. It's learning about tactics, maybe. And serious games are actually very old, and this is the point where I bring the kitten picture, yeah? So no talk without kittens. Serious games are something that is invented by nature. So the reason why we play, the reason that we play, is something nature came up with. Yeah? So every higher animal is playing, at least in a like youth state. Yeah? Why do they play? Because they learn. Yeah? Playing is trying out, learning, getting reinforcement from the outside, and adapting to an uncertain environment and to an uncertain world. Yeah? So you have to learn how to evade predators, you have to learn how to find prey, yeah? You have to learn how to deal with your comrades in your clan, and this is play for to learn. So play is super motivating, and we learn a lot by that. And now I come back to that hospital image I showed you before. When I was in that hospital and I watched that surgery, later on I sat together with the chief surgeon there with a cup of coffee, and then I asked him, how long did that guy need for training? So the other guy who controlled the camera. Yeah? Because I thought as a computer scientist, let's do a training tool for surgeons to do the camera thing. And then he told me, and this was very disappointing because I could immediately wipe away all my plans to do a computer training tool for that. Then he told me he's doing that for the first time. And I was like, how can he do that? And then he told me he's not even a doctor. He's a student of medicine. And then he told me, you know, these young male students, they are so good in hand-eye coordination because they play so many first-person shooters. Watching there, doing the mouse here, they literally don't need any training. You can put them there and they can do it. So once again, games seem to be sometimes good for something and sometimes you don't know beforehand for what. So games are a driver of technology, and we use games quite a lot in our lab for various purposes. One thing is we train robots with games. Here, this is a research endeavor in the SFB in Bremen on everyday activity and training robots. This robot is supposed to do pancakes in everyday households. Yeah? So the challenge is not in a factory where everything is well defined, but in your household. So the robot doesn't know beforehand how your pan exactly looks like, how your spatula exactly looks like. Yeah? So this is what the robot has to adapt to. And you need a lot of training data to make robots perform on that in a really flexible way. And one thing we did, and we do, is to employ games. Yeah? Because it's pretty boring for people to show a robot 10,000 times how to cook. Yeah? It's not rewarding. Yeah? You have to pay students a lot of money for doing that. And when they get bored, the data quality goes down. So what we did is we did a tower defense game. Looks simple, but it was engaging enough so we could show that people really liked it and they produce better data. And what they do is they put the towers there and they have to do that with hand movements that are similar to putting things on a stove. And they can turn things around and they can power them up by pouring some liquid onto certain towers, and they have to do these movements, and then eventually the creeps come in on that line over there, and when you did all correctly, then you get some points. And this was enough, so it's a simple game, only like student product, yeah, but it was enough to show that it's performing better than letting people doing that virtually without a game. Another area where we worked with games is games for health. This is Jan Smedding, who did his PhD with us and is now a professor at Newcastle University. Here we worked on exergames, so games that help to do physiotherapy. We started that initially with Parkinson's disease patients, and for them it's vital to do regular exercises, otherwise they get super stiff and they have to do that like every day. They are super frustrated because this disease is not really motivating. And so how can we stimulate them to do exercises? And what we did is we worked together with them and then did exergames to, for instance, increase the functional reach. This is what this exercise is about, of your hands. We also did that with physiotherapists for back pain, and we have quite a number of projects in that area. And did adaptive exergames so that the game adapts to your health state. And it actually works. So in particular, we could show that older patients, people above 60, even above 70, really like it, they appreciate it. And we have some very good experience with people doing exergames with our games, and they really like it. And we could show that it also can increase the functional reach, which was one of the measures here for physiotherapy. Now, coming to the last point, I said empowering digital media also involves naturalness of interaction. And what do we mean by natural? And that's a bit of a hard term because it's not well defined. And there is a big debate in the community what natural interaction means. Is it natural language? Is it whatever? Yeah? Even though there's no good definition, it's still a good term. So if we use it, and natural in a way means for us or in the community very often, whenever you can use like natural gestures, your body, when you can use natural ways of doing something as you would do it with our digital tools. This would be like an example of what you do naturally. Sculpting, for instance, you would do that with your hands. Puppeteering, you would do that with your hands. Writing, traditionally, you did that with your hands. Yeah? And when you today do 3D modeling, like sculpting or animation, you do that with tools like Blender, Maya, or other tools, and they are really painful. I don't know if anyone used Maya, Blender, etc., and tried to do 3D modeling. It's quite a burden, and it quite takes a while to get there. And so our goal was to look for tools on democratizing 3D animation and 3D creation, because we thought, why not making that as easy as photography, filming, or audio processing? So today, photography is something everybody can do. Yeah? 50 years ago, that was not the case. Yeah? So you needed courses for doing proper photography. Yeah? So today you have so many tools and stuff and you can do professional looking photos with your smartphone. And so our goal was in this project here, First Stage, to do natural, fast, easy 3D content creation tools for creative people. And with creative people, we mean directors of photography in film, or we mean stage designers in theater. And the idea was, how can we improve generating scenes for them by using natural interaction forms? And very often that means to use your hands. When I want to describe a scene to you, I want to describe a stage, I would say there is a stage, there is a gate, there is a chair, and I would use my hands, put that there. And why not having an interface that is as simple and that people can use in that way? And we did that in various ways, and I just show you two quick prototypes. So one thing we did is a sandbox that you see up there, and people have a VR glass, and then they can model a shape, a surface with the sandbox. They can add water and put a water level there, and they can add trees, put them into the sandbox, and then they can switch the perspective, go like into the scene, look around there, go back from the scene and model that scene. Another thing we did, so here you see like the water level thing. Now it's taking trees and putting them into the scene. And there are like a few cool things in there. For instance, this bottle, and you can take a tree in the bottle, and then you pour trees on the scene, pour them on there. It always looks better when you wear the glasses and when you don't have that perspective through that glass, and people really liked it. Another thing, this is a study we did for stage design, and in particular here, this is an animation company that gave us the data, so it's a stage of an animation trick film, and this is Lottie, a cartoon figure, and the backyard, and what we did here is you have VR glasses, and then you can move the props around, like in a little puppet house, and then we investigated how realistic do these props have to be. And we printed them out in 3D print, so they really feel like the same shape that you see. And we tried what happens if you just take Lego figures instead. Is that sufficient? Or what happens if you only take these wooden circular things? Is that sufficient? And what we found out is actually Lego figures are pretty cool. They are completely sufficient, so it doesn't have to feel realistic. It just has to be close enough so you can prototype the thing that you touch with Lego, have the glasses, and then it's a very realistic thing and people can create with that. And this question of like in mixed reality, or now today people say X reality, this question on how realistic does it have to be is something that drives us in a number of projects. This is one project concerning climbing. And I told you Bremen is flat, but we at least have a climbing gym. So there it goes a bit up. And we had a study here in the climbing gym where we investigated how realistic does it have to be in order to feel such that you are frightened of high. Yeah? And the thing is, you need something to hold on. So if you only have the controllers, that's not sufficient. But if you have grips, then it feels quite realistic and people have the same fear of falling than they have in reality. So grasping things is important. Grasping is for comprehension important. It's for learning important. It's for creating important. Another project is here on algebra learning, on tangible interaction. These are so-called algebra tiles in different prototypes. And it goes to, back to the constructivist learning theory by Peppert and others. And this was a project we did together with math didactics people, where kids had to learn math, simple equation, linear equations with tangibles. This was an event where Anja Karliczek, the Bundesministerin, looked at the demo, and as you know, she likes schools a lot, way more than science. So we could convince her this is a cool prototype. And now going back to medicine and grasping things and combining that with VR, and this is the last thing I want to show you here from this portfolio of projects. A project we just recently started. Again, we are together here with surgeons. And one thing we want to do there is we want to have VR glasses where surgeons can look at the data. So they can have a three-dimensional liver, see all the vessels, can see the tumor in there. But the thing is, there's no haptics. And in this project, we want to give them haptics because surgeons, or if you go to the doctor, typically they touch you. Yeah? They don't only look at you, they want to feel it. Yeah? And so we give the surgeons touch, and we do that by printing out organs. So the idea is we have a printout liver, including the tumor, and we print it out in a flexible material that has the same viscosity than the liver. Yeah? And so the surgeon can have the glasses on, we track the liver, we track the hands, and then the surgeon can touch the liver, can touch the tumor, and then can, through the VR glasses, overlay the information with like the vessels and see what happens there. So this is a project we do at the moment together with Pius Hospital, and this is a partner here, Apokla. And the company, this is actually a Baden-Württemberg company who does the printouts, ZILP in Heimsheim. They do really cool stuff. So again, yeah, we want to give the surgeons power. We want to empower them. They should be competent in doing what they do. And we don't want to take away the competence. Yeah? We don't want to put an intelligent system there and then the surgeon only is operating the system, but rather the surgeon should do his or her job in the best possible way, supported by our systems. So what we aim for is we want to shape digital media, and we think that this also shapes the digital society. We think there's a necessary shift in HCI, so I think we have to go away from only user experience. I think positive computing, eudaimonic HCI, as you want to name it, is an interesting concept we should follow. We want to develop for meaningfulness, playfulness, and naturalness, and we want to go towards empowering digital media. And this is also the title of the graduate college we have, funded by the Klaus Tschirra Foundation. I'm very grateful for that. And this brings me back to my beginning at this place here. I came here because I met Klaus Tschirra, and I had the honor of getting yet another award, the Klaus Tschirra Prize für Verständliche Wissenschaft in 1996. And when he gave me the prize, we had a chat, and he told me, I'm starting this foundation and I'm starting a research lab. And I said, cool, hire me. And that's what he did in a way. And this is how I came here. And by that time, I was working on neural networks and on modeling learning in brains. And then I did completely different stuff. And he gave me the freedom to do so. And he gave me the freedom and space and funding to do all this stuff. And still, the Klaus Tschirra Foundation supports us at the graduate college. And that's fantastic. And in the best of like Klaus Tschirra's heritage, I think, this is what he was always after, yeah, to make this place a better place and to use science for good, yeah, for something that changes the world in a positive way. And this is sort of where I'm still addicted. And I hope to carry on the flag, yeah, and to build cool IT that really helps people and empowers people. And in this way, I'm super glad to be back here. And I hope this was an interesting view for you on what we do, an interesting update. I hope you didn't know that all before. And it's like a quick run through everything. And thanks for your attention and thanks for coming.